Okay, so I go by Carlations, and I just wanted to, because there's some confusion sometimes, Carla Wyzgala, sometimes as Aaron just asks me, people don't know how to pronounce my name, so it's both. I graduated in 2009 in the illustration department, and I do all watercolor from this day on forever. Will always do watercolor. I work within the webcomic industry, and the fantasy pinup is kind of my jam. So some of you may have heard the talk when I was here with Caleb King and the Surreality. We did a Kickstarter, and we talked all about the Kickstarter campaign, I think about a year ago. And so some of you might know a little bit about that already. These are our characters. Basically, I met Caleb here, and he has a crazy imagination and was always creating this story about this girl with the blue hair. Her name's Sydney, and decided after, you know, having me in class a lot of, well, most of the time that we were here, that he wanted to work with me. So after we graduated, he contacted me and just said, you know, we got to make this a webcomic, and you're going to draw it. And I said, okay. And I didn't know exactly what that meant. I had never really done panel work before, and I would like to say that I just kind of made my own way of doing it. This is an example of a page that is part of a dream sequence in our story. And as you can see, I kind of just didn't follow any traditional rules, I guess. Definitely just made it my own. And I think that's something that's eye-catching, that we actually get a lot of, like, good job for. I'm also the pencil and inker for the book. So we have a colorist that does the rest of the pages digitally. And every time there's a dream sequence, it's in watercolor. Because Caleb was really playing towards my strengths and knew that we wanted to have watercolor, but knew that it takes a lot of time having a weekly updated webcomic to do a new page in watercolor every single week. So this is an example of the pencil and inking that I do. And with Surreality, we've developed a very good relationship. We can talk about our feelings. We can talk about, you know, what would make the work environment better. We definitely play to each other's strengths. And now we travel all over the country doing comic conventions. And has anyone been to a comic convention? Most of you. They're pretty fun. I definitely encourage anyone with any interest who hasn't gone to go and check it out. It is pretty much a job fair. There's people just in the entire industry that you'd ever want to meet if you have an interest in doing it. I didn't really know what I was getting into the first time I went. I had I believe it was a bulletin board behind me that I pinned some prints up on, which if you go to a comic convention, you know that people have very, very extensive displays. Not quite like that, but that's how I started. And each year, displays got a little bit better. Now, like I said, I'm traveling with Caleb and Andrew Day, and we're kind of the Surreality team. And we sell books, we have prints, and it's very doable. Like I said, each year that you go, you kind of improve what you were selling last year, or what it looked like, what you're telling people, giving out business cards. It's all part of the game. So you definitely have to keep people interested. I usually have a new print available that's like an exclusive type of deal every year to get people to come back. You can have giveaways, stickers, anything just to let people listen to you talk about this thing that you do. Definitely make sure that there's eye candy at the table. Like I said, there's gotta be something that really grabs them from far away. My display now is about like 10 feet tall, just so that everybody can see it from far away, because I'm small. and it really helps. People are like, I've seen that before. And definitely we've created this logo and this look almost within just our color scheme. I don't know if you've noticed, the past three images have all definitely been kind of this rainbow of colors. And I've been told a few different times when people come to the table, like, I've seen this, I know this, that's good. That's a very good thing. And it always helps to have eye candy, like I said, at the table. We also do, as a marketing tool that I just kind of fell into, I was using a lot of references just based off of some suicide girls that have on Instagram all these pictures. And this is actually an example of one. And she saw it, the girl who this is modeled after, and loved it. She put it all over her page, and now suddenly we've got a bunch of people following our webcomic, which is pretty cool. So use whatever tools are available to you. As you can see, I don't exactly draw big brawny men fighting, which is somewhat limiting to the industry, but also makes us stand out. It's mostly just because I don't want to. And I decided I'm not going to. So pinup art is definitely what I consider myself, pinup artist. Being female also in the comic book industry is definitely rare, but not as rare anymore. Anything that can make you stand out is a good thing, no matter what that is. As long as it's in a good way, I should say. Just a bit of advice is to stay true to what it is that you like to draw. While you're a student here, there may be projects that you may not want to do, but I think when I was here, I really tried to find a way to make it still me. And I think that's something that you can all, I think anyone can do that, no matter what the project is. And if you have to break a few rules to make it a better piece, I'd say do it. I also have a lot of influence from the master artist. This is all poses from Gil Elfgren that I've then created into the Gotham Girls. And this is very recognizable. I've got a lot of people recognize it as his work, and then they also appreciate that it's something new, a way that they haven't seen these characters before, which, like I said, is good to just kind of reinvent something familiar. I also sell a lot at local shops. This image is very popular in Chicago, which is pretty cool. I sell at a few different local shops that really only do Chicago type of artwork, and that is definitely a good way to get your name out there also. I put together an answer for a question that is usually very hard to answer. That is, what do I do? And to answer that, technically, I work from home. I'm my own boss. I'm my own secretary, I'm my own mail person. I have to go to the post office almost every other day. I answer emails all the time. I definitely fill all the hats of the job. But like I said, I'm my own boss. It has its perks. What I do when I'm not on the road at the comic conventions is usually either paint whatever I want, which is pretty cool, paint a commission piece. So if somebody, for instance, wants, this is something that I would do for fun. And then doing conventions and having a fan base, people understand, like, this is what she does, I want one. This is an example of something that was commissioned. It's pretty similar, which is fun, makes my job fun. This is a design for somebody who wanted this tattooed on them, and they wanted it this specific dinosaur, and then she just kind of said, do what you do. And that makes me very happy. And that is possible, that happens a lot. And then, for instance, I'm also working on prints and new pieces for the next convention. This would be an example of that. It's about once or twice a month that I'm traveling to the comic conventions. If you look at the schedule, there's pretty much one every weekend, if not two or three. And you can really make it work as far as doing that full time. I've found that, you know, through a couple years of really familiarizing yourself with traveling and how to save on expenses and all that fun in the airport and everything, if you can drive to a show, that makes it worth it. I think it's very doable if anyone has any interest in it. There's a Lady Thor. So like I said, I have to be my own boss. I have to make my own deadlines. Some personality traits make that easier than others. I find it very easy to make my own deadline. It's very motivating when you get paid after a job also, which is, like I said, everything's determined by me. I'm making my own contract. I'm setting my own prices. I'm making all the arrangements on shipping. I do all of that. So it's really up to me to make sure that that's on time, to make people, like, to keep people happy. And, you know, if a commission is going to take over a year, that's going to start to make somebody angry. I try and keep everything within 3 months tops. I don't get a paycheck, obviously. So spacing this out took a few years to figure out how to make this work. It's definitely okay to have side jobs. I was a hostess for like 5 years out of my life, and it was totally fine. It was some extra cash to get the bills paid. Then once I was finally realizing I could be working on some new artwork instead of being at a restaurant, and I was okay, and I was able to float myself, that's the day that I quit. Not having a paycheck means you really, a lot of illustrators are going to face this, where you really have to figure out what season is the hot season and what's not. There's, within the comic convention world, there's spring and fall that all the big shows are. And then around Christmas time, there's nothing, which is mostly just because people aren't thinking about cosplay when it's about to be Christmas. They really are with family and everything. So keeping that in mind, it took a few years to really, really budget and be your own accountant also. If there's anything that helps you at this age, just, I would say, really keep track even now at everything that you do and how much you're getting paid for every little thing, and really, really keep good notes on that. Come tax season, it could be a nightmare if you don't have all that information. Like I said, I'm doing all of that myself. I've got a tax guy, but I really have to tell him out of 10 different sources where I'm getting paid. So that's something that I never really thought about before. I definitely thought this job was going to be getting paychecks and having direct deposit. Every time I'm asked if I want direct deposit at the bank, I say no. I don't have any paycheck. It's all coming from like five different places. So definitely with what I do, that's an example. The webcomic that we do is free. So you probably wonder, how are we making money off of that? Well, it's free to read online, but the conventions is where we sell books and prints, and find that giving some things for free definitely pays off. You get people interested. They want to know more. Some people prefer it in book form. And definitely having other merchandise also. There's also commission paintings that I do for the book. So we'll actually sell paintings based off of the characters. I also sell stuff like this at the booth. This image is very popular because she's a cool person. So it's definitely a balance of drawing what you like and what is going to sell, if that makes sense, without completely selling your soul. Don't ever do that. Make sure you stay happy. This is an example of one of the first illustration jobs that I got, and it was basically from searching the web. I don't even know if the site is available anymore, but it was somewhere, it was basically like a Craigslist for artists. And I went on there, this guy wanted illustrations for a game that he was putting out. It was just a little card game. I set a price for each painting, and he paid it. So this is a little card game size print that he now has my name on, and I can sell the paintings for it. That's just an example of one of the very minuscule jobs that I got from the very beginning, just from searching. Just search the internet. There's a million jobs out there. Make sure you're not getting scammed, though. go to Rich and ask him if it's a scam, if you have a question. He'll tell you. I found that was actually one of the most, like, that was the day that I realized that I'm an illustrator when I did this job, because before it was, you know, it was commissions of people's, you know, their wife or their dog or whatever you can to pay the bills. But this one was really fun, and I was like, wow, I can do this. I also have worked on, it's very important to make friends while you're here. I can't stress that enough. These are, your peers are all people that you should be working with. This is another project that I worked on with another student that was in my graduating class, and he's doing his own webcomic. Actually, it's just a comic, graphic novel, and he's commissioned me to do several different cover art paintings for him. So this is an example of one of those. I also did a Kickstarter for this book, and I found that a lot of people wanted to know about how to do watercolor, and I'm sure half of you know how to do watercolor very well also. It's in demand, surprisingly, especially in the comics industry, because most of it is digital. That works out to my advantage, because then people come by and they're like, what is this? How do you do that? So now I have a book that explains it. It's on my table. Successfully kickstarted. If anyone doesn't know what Kickstarter is, it basically finds your fans for you, people who would pay money to have this product that you haven't made yet because you can't fund it yourself, which is amazing. So that is how I was able to do that. And I can pass this around if you want to look. That definitely makes it easier than shelling out the money to pay for, say, 1,000 copies of a book. So the masquerade, Skull Masquerade, is one of the series of paintings that I did for the book to show as an example. So as I was working, I was taking picture, process photos, and showing each stage of the painting, and then put it all together in the book, and it's pretty self-explanatory. So even if people aren't going to be doing watercolor professionally, if they just want to do it for fun and they're like, this medium looks hard, now they have an example. And I like to share the love for watercolor. So selling on online shops is also a good idea. I don't know if any of you guys have heard of Etsy. Probably most of you. There's Etsy, there's Society6, there's all sorts of companies out there that want to sell your artwork and give you money for it. That's cool. That should be something you want to do too. Etsy is all run by selling out of your house. You know, you have to actually package everything yourself, which I would say invest in a good printer and or make friends with your local printer, a scanner. Make sure that you have everything that you need to do your craft, and you can do it yourself. There's a lot of DIY help out there that has made this possible that didn't exist before. I was joking because Instagram didn't even exist while I was in college. That's crazy, because now I use that as most of my marketing. So I would say look into whatever is the right source for you. Etsy has a lot of its own fan base. There's people that just troll that site just looking for stuff to buy. I mean, they've got their credit cards ready. They're just waiting for something to strike their fancy. So you can start small. I think my shop had 5 items in it when I first started, and I probably sold one thing that first year. And that's okay, because you have to start somewhere. And throughout the years now, it's regular, and I've got people coming back for more, and it's very doable. So with that, I would say get your work out there wherever necessary, wherever you can. If people can't see it, I'm sure you've been told this, if they can't see it, they don't know it exists. Handing out business cards, going to either a gallery or a convention or somewhere where there's masses of people that are interested in art is always a good idea. Even if you may not have that one painting that you've been wanting to show everyone, you've got other bodies of work, I'd say get it out there. Have a website that's working and up to date, and really, really follow through with everything that you have to show your portfolio. Like I said, I use Instagram a lot now. There's no pictures of cheeseburgers and beer on my Instagram. It's all artwork. You could save that for people without talent. just put your artwork out there, and I put different process photos and different stuff than what's on my website. So Instagram has its own fan base also. People like myself check it every single day to see what's new, and I think there's no better way than to show your artwork than that. Using hashtags and keywords and any kind of code as intelligently as possible definitely helps. This would be hashtag Chicago, and then people will see it, and that's cool. That is the easiest way for people to see your artwork. Post this, hashtag Chicago, 1 million people see it. It's that easy, honestly. I have a group on Facebook that I found through doing all sorts of different art auctions. I was on Top Hatter, if anyone's heard of that, which formed into this group of artists that all have similar art style, and we just formed our own Facebook group that now has monthly auctions right on Facebook. So this is a piece that our monthly theme was Stardust, and I painted this, and I ended up selling it that month, which is always good. This was something that was based off of, I think the monthly theme was Clint, and that's based off of the Judith piece of his, which also sold. This is a list of all the social media that I use, most of it. Actually, there's still more than that I don't check that much. If you don't have every single one of these, you might want to. It's definitely constructive, and they all have their own society around them. There's people that use Twitter that don't use Instagram. So the easiest thing you can do is just do it all, and then they will see it. Meeting other professionals also through this way. I've definitely made friends with other people in the cyber world, and then finally met them and paired up for clients. collaborations and all sorts of fun things. So that's what I'm stressing. I think that is everything that I had planned, and I definitely want to take questions if anyone has any.
Sure. For the places that you posted your art, have you considered opening a Tumblr?
I have. Tumblr is one thing that I haven't done yet, but there's definitely a big group for Tumblr. Yes.
Carla.
Yeah.
I'll just speak as loud as I can. One thing that you obviously would love to do now. One thing I think you really would obviously like to do is a lot more figurative concept artwork. Your stuff screams for that. I know you've done a lot of Disney-ish stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You were talking to me earlier about the plans of moving.
Yes.
Do you want to talk a little bit about
yes.
that?
Yes. Rich wants me to talk about moving.
Yeah.
Chicago is a little bit limited with the conceptual field and also animation, definitely. I was just recently in LA last weekend for Kamikaze, which is Stan Lee's comic convention, and it was just surrounded by people who are in the conceptual world and working for Disney and all these big name places. So there is a plan in my future to move with my husband of 1 month to California.
Congratulations.
He's a tattoo artist. He also went to the school. And he's already got a job placement there. I feel the moment I get there, I'm going to feel at home. When I was visiting, it was very much surrounded by everything that I draw already. So that was definitely inspirational. And actually, from doing the show, I had business cards out on the table, and someone had grabbed it and referred it to their friend, who happened to be the, a head person at Jack's Toys, and so every little show that you do, your card could end up in the right hands, and it eventually gets to the point where they're coming to you and they're like, you have great work, I want you to do this.
And what did Jack's Toys hire you to do?
They wanted conceptual design. They see that I draw a lot of females and in different kind of costuming. So I have a feeling they kind of threw out there that there could be some designs for Tinkerbell in a more modern outfit, which is very cool. I would love to do that. So, and that would be a full-time position in the LA area. So sometimes you gotta move. That's okay. Did you have a question?
I was just going to ask, out of all the areas of work that you do, where does most of your income come from?
Most of it right now comes from doing the conventions. And that is a mixture of the sales at the show. Like I said, it's the place where millions of people come and have money to spend. And they're there to buy. A lot of people know that there's going to be a lot of really good artwork. And there's a little bit of competition, obviously, amongst all the other artists, but that is where most of it comes from. Selling posters, prints, the original paintings, books, all of that, which I'm supplying myself. I've just kind of printed everything myself and, eat the cost at the time of, and then it all gets reimbursed for sure. And then the other half part of it is that there's people that commission paintings from that. They'll see something like this and say, I want it like that, but this, and it's just for their house, or it's for their company, or it could be for many different things. So, yes.
Do those people expect to keep the copyright, or do you pull them right away?
That's a good question. So copyright it's your call. I stress in all of the paintings that I sell that they know that I have the copyright to make prints and posters of the image. They just have the original painting. Now, if it's for someone's actual, like if it's for the game design, I give them permission to use for that, and they've paid for that. They can use it for their game. They can't sell prints of it. They can sell their game with the images on. So it's really project-based, and you want to hold on to your copyrights of everything that you do should you want to make prints of it and actually sell the image also. So that's a good question. Yeah?
Can you talk more about the local shops that you sell your work at?
Sure. There's a lot that are coffee shops that also sell art. I sell at Wolf Bait in Logan Square, and it's kind of the central Logan Square shop that everyone goes to for gifts that have the Chicago flag on everything. That's where I started. There's millions of them all over the city. Walk into even your local comic book shop will have a section for artwork. Or even your own book. So I think depending on where you are, you can find any local shop that sells artwork and sell there. And they usually have like, Wolf Bait, for instance, has a 50-50 payout. So I have to mark everything up, but people will still buy it. So, and that's supporting the local shop, which is always good.
When you're at your comic shows, are you pricing all your own work, and do you do any negotiating with people who haggle a little? Are you willing to do it? Or?
For sure. Yeah, everything is priced however I want it to. And that's, I remember that being a question that I asked as a student, is how do you price your work? I think it takes one experience of selling something for too little that is kind of raises your bar. I remember selling a painting that I really liked for $75, and I regretted it instantly when he handed me a $100 bill to pay for it. It's like, wow, okay, that was not a good choice. But that raised my bar. It's like, okay, he was willing to pay $100, so that's where I stand. And then, you know, goes from there. I think at a show, people are fast to haggle. There's a lot of sales that you could do, like 3 for $20 and 2 for $30 and all sorts of bundle deals, because at a show they're getting a chance to meet you, and it's gonna be more appetizing to, you want them to buy there instead of when they get home and maybe forget about it. So that always helps. Yes.
Anybody else?
Good question for
Thanks.
Me. Thank
Carla.
You.